So Trump just fired Tillerson because apparently we haven't quite reached a ridiculous headline quota for this week yet. Come on, can't we keep the conversation on one topic for long enough that my video will be relevant for longer than the time it takes to write a tweet? Now, before we talk about the drama, I just want to create this highlight reel of his accomplishments.
Secretary of State Rex Tillerson learned he was fired at the same time the rest of the world did, on Twitter.
Wait, that's it? Well, I guess he did call the president a moron as well, but if that's an accomplishment, then my mom would make a great Secretary of State. Tillerson was the shortest-lived fired Secretary of State since 1898, a time when the only tweet that could fire you was from a messenger pigeon. Also, to clarify, that other guy was not so much fired as promoted to a Supreme Court justice. That said, the biggest worry for some isn't what Tillerson did, but what he wouldn't do. You can tell that he had a large impact because he was the one who pushed Trump to renew the Iran deal, not move the capital to Israel, and even on the same day Trump announced meeting with North Korea saying,
Tillerson, speaking on Thursday while on his first trip to Africa, said while the signals from Pyongyang may be positive, direct negotiations are still a long way off.
He wasn't totally wrong. I mean, it was a few hours from happening. That said, while he did have a voice in the room, it was always coming up with the boring status quo decisions. Rex, should we move our capital to Jerusalem? I agree, let's do it. Fortunately, his successor holds more similar ideas to Trump than Tillerson, so we can probably look forward to seeing more of Trump in the future of foreign policies. So you know all that fun domestic stability we've been enjoying in the first season of this TV experience? Well, get ready to see all that on the international stage for
land, air, and sea. We may even have a space force.
No, I hate it when they set my favorite franchises in space. So yes, if historians remember Rex Tillerson for anything, it's going to be because he was the guy who got fired via Twitter. Today I want to talk about Mike Pompeo, the person who's replacing Rex Tillerson as Secretary of State, and Gina Haspel, the person who's replacing Mike Pompeo as Chief of the CIA. First, let's talk about Mike Pompeo's replacement, who is, well, interesting. Gina Haspel looks harder to hate than a puppy who has a best friend of a kitten. Only problem, she might have a pending warrant for her arrest in Europe for torturing government detainees in Thailand in 2002. Interestingly enough, after 9/11, the first place America chose to open up a black site was in Thailand, led by her. And she's been breaking all sorts of glass ceilings with detainees' heads since. Now, when I hear that the new CIA director tortured detainees in 2002, that sounds like something not even Wolf Blitzer would consider breaking news. And that guy calls breaking news so often I wouldn't be surprised if the breaking news animation were credited as a contributor on his show at this point. I think he actually broke the news. Now, what's different about this new CIA director is a few things. First, this site was actually for experimenting and perfecting enhanced interrogation techniques, and they were less concerned with the most ethical ways of interrogating people, and more concerned with breaking the world record for longest breath held. So, what does any of this mean? I mean, I'm sure Mike Pompeo dunked a few people in his day. Well, the big difference is that Mike Pompeo said that he would not reintroduce torture during his time as director of the CIA while interviewing for the job of leading the CIA. Although, that was a job interview, a time when people are about as honest as they are filling out a dating profile. Oh yeah, I'm sure you learned all about database restructuring during your 3 months as a Starbucks barista. The point here is that, officially, while consistently supporting enhanced interrogation, which is the GoBots to torture's Transformers, Trump has said that many times he wants to bring back torture, so it would make sense that he would appoint the Steve Jobs of torture innovation to a CIA directorial position. When liberals told you to finally appoint someone with some experience, I'm not sure that this is exactly what they had in mind. This CIA director might be more amenable to some of Trump's more controversial ideas. Specifically, his desire to bring back black sites, which he drafted an executive order for. Unfortunately, one of the many mistakes in that executive order was that it got the date of 9/11 wrong. What? How do you screw up the date of the September 11th attacks? That's literally the name. That's like looking at Toys R Us and saying, they must be a tax preparation company. All that said, for some of you, that might be a hard pill to swallow. Although, with the proper tools, I'm sure Gina Haspel could help. If you can overlook her torture past, she's actually a pretty good candidate, though. First, she has actual experience working in the area she's been hired to work in, which, for this White House, almost makes you overqualified. And I'm glad we're not seeing the CIA director Bannon, although he is quite good at running misinformation campaigns. She is also backed by several previous CIA directors, and from what I've read, she actually has a good reputation in the department. It's really a question of how high a priority you put on not torturing people, a point that, ironically enough, probably sounds absurd to both sides of this debate for opposite reasons. So now, I would like to take a second to talk about our new friend Secretary Pompeo, because, well, he is US foreign policy now. So he's a little less controversial because he hasn't been connected to systemic breaking of international human rights laws. But it is important to note that he has a CIA background as well, which many speculate has some unique positives and negatives. Specifically,
I think that Mike Pompeo, coming with the knowledge that he has of working at CIA, about the active measures that the Russians have been involved in for decades, and most recently using the means of technology, that in fact he will, as Nick suggests, be able to reach the president with the high impact of what those active measures are by way of intromission into our political system and undercutting democracy at a full scale.
Mike Pompeo has been exposed to decades of data collected by the CIA while working there. And despite the fact that in the time I've been writing this show, I've seen a truly stunning lack of intellectual curiosity to the point where I'm not willing to make assumptions about anybody, I'd just like to assume that being in the proximity to all of that information would give even the most unaware person a generally good idea of the world. I get it. You can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink it. Well, with the right CIA strategies, you definitely could, but that's a separate story. The point here is that Secretary Pompeo has a unique knowledge of politics from an intelligence perspective, after having worked in the intelligence gathering community for so long. He does support the president's opinions as well, but I look forward to hearing from an advisor with more data floating around in his head than which country has the biggest oil fields.
This is a man with prior government experience, both in the military, in the Congress, in the CIA, and now soon to be in the State Department. So I think he's got excellent preparation for the job, which I think is going to enable him to give clear assessments to the president about the ways right. in which we should conduct our diplomacy.
That said, he does bring with him some more hawkish ideas regarding some countries, consistent with viewpoints expressed by the president. While Russia might be a point of contention between Pompeo and Trump, we'll just put it this way. I'd much rather be Israel than Iran right now. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Join us this Saturday for a special episode of Supreme Court Saturday, where we're going to be going back to 1973 to discuss the intricacies of Roe vs. Wade. Hey YouTube, hope you enjoyed this episode. Click on this logo to get access to our regular episodes, and click here for an episode of mine that YouTube thinks you would like the most. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that.